favourite indigenous Jess, also known as Synchro, is going to be talking to us about bath flower remedies. I don't know how many people have encountered them. They're incredibly small things, but they are incredibly powerful. Subtle little resonances that are put inside us out of a little bottle. And Jess is going to give us a quick summary of all the bar flower remedies and then speak to us a little bit about how to make your own remedies, including producing a resilience remedy from these beautiful little campanula flowers down here, which have been sitting soaking up the atmosphere of the whole gig. So I'll get out of the way. I've had plenty of time studying up here this weekend. And round of applause for Jess and the bar flower remedies.
Well, thank you all for coming out at this early hour. It's really lovely to see you all here. It's brilliant. I just made it myself. So this is the first talk I've ever given on the bath flower remedies. I've never really given a presentation on them before, although I've been familiar with these remedies now since 1988. Somebody I met in Llandrindod Wells in Mid Wales in one day introduced me to three things that became really central to my life. One of them was colour therapy, one of them was the Bach flower remedies, and the other thing was the I Ching. Are you all familiar with those topics? Although we're not going to go into the other topics, but those three things became really central to my life. I ended up studying as a Bach flower therapist, as a colour therapist, and I've been using the I Ching for many, many years for helping with questions in our lives. Who's used the I Ching here amongst us, just as a matter of interest? Yeah. Anyway, it's a very, very, very interesting collection of wisdom that you can use as a divinatory thing, full of wisdom. And when I was introduced to the Bach remedies, I was on my way to Nepal, or Nepal as we call it, for 2 years. I was setting off on a 2-year journey to live in the Himalayas. So it was a really, really good time for me to be introduced to them. And the first thing I did was I went out and I bought a set, not this actual one, but I bought the complete set of remedies and I put them in my rucksack and I took them with me. I also bought this book, Bach Flower Therapies by Theory and Practice by Mechthild Schaefer. And I still think this is one of the best books on the topic that you'll find. She's written a new book, but actually her new book, although it's got some lovely colour photos, hasn't got any more wisdom than this book's got in it. It's really, really excellent book. And she hasn't diverged at all really from Bach's original wisdom. Some people have taken this system and done other things with it, which is fine, but myself, I like to stay fairly true to Bach's original wisdom. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be running through the whole set of remedies very briefly with a photograph, just to show you what they look like, and if you can familiarize yourself with the plants as they grow in the wild, that's also really good. Because as you know, I'm really finding things in the wild. But basically, the Bach flower remedies are a vibrational frequency medicine. And as we know, everything is frequency. Everything is vibration. We all have vibrations and frequencies that are unique to each of us. This field has a frequency which is unique to it. This part of our planet has its own frequency. The planet has its own frequency. And all of the planets in our solar system have their own unique signature frequency. And this applies to everything that is growing, particularly everything that is alive has a very particular frequency. So what Bach did, and he was a very sensitive man, he travelled the land, mostly Britain, sometimes Wales, sometimes England, and he must have gone somewhere else, he must have gone to the Mediterranean as well for plants like olive. But most of his research was done in this country, And although he'd come from a homeopathic background, he was a top-class homeopath of his time, and he made some breakthroughs in homeopathy. What he wanted to do was to find a simple set of remedies that anybody could use. Because as you probably know, homeopathy is a very complex field. I don't know if there are any people here who study homeopathy. It's a very, very complex field. And what Bach wanted to do is to develop a system that would be accessible and so simple so that everybody could use it. And not just use the remedies that the Bach Center were making and that he made, but also he propagated the ability for everybody to make their own essences. So you don't need to buy any Bach flower remedies. You might want to, but it's easy to go and buy a bottle, but you can actually make all of these essences for yourself, and you can also make essences from anything you want to. And we know somebody down in near Glastonbury who makes the most wonderful essences. And she makes them at the point of the full moon with bee magic. You know, not actually crushing up a bee to go in the essence, but there'll be a bee present and it'll be a full moon, and she'll make an essence to encapsulate that moment. And we know from our own experience that her earth consciousness essence is just stunning. So you just spray a little bit onto your third eye and woof, it's really uplifting. So you can make essences from just about anything. So Bach was so sensitive that he could take a petal from a gorse bush, for example, put it on his tongue, and he would temporarily experience the state that flower would be able to help. He knew intuitively what that remedy would be for. So he started off with a very small group of essences. I think he started off with 7 essences, and he thought, that's it, it's complete. And then he discovered a few more, so they became 12. And in the end, he ended up with 38 essences made from plants, most of which can be found growing wild in our land. He put a lot of work into this research, and he actually died quite young, our Edward Bach. He didn't live a long life, but before he died, he completed this system for our use. Now, you've probably heard, nowadays, all over the planet, people are making flower essences, tree essences, Australian bush essences. All over the world, people are making essences, which is fantastic, because people are tuning into the energy of the plant and what it can do for us, or the energy of the moon, or whatever it is you're making an essence from. But he wanted to keep this system simple, and it is essentially a very, very simple system. Each remedy can be described using very few words. And if that remedy is the one that you need, you'll probably know straight away when you hear the summary of that essence that it is one that you could do with. Or you'll know somebody who perhaps could do with some of that essence. And that's how we familiarize ourselves with these 38 remedies. There's a suggestion that you might like to, I mean, I do it all the time now. If I'm reading a book, I think, oh, I'd love to give him a bit of beech, or, you know, whatever comes to mind. Or you can use fairy tales. Cinderella, for example, you might like to give her some essences. It would change the story, but it's good practice to do that. Or Hamlet. We'll talk about Hamlet probably as we go through. Again, you would be completely changing the outcome of Shakespeare's play if you gave Hamlet some flower essences. It would sort him out, possibly with a bit less death in there than there is at the end of the play. So I started, when I went to Nepal with this box of essences, I started with self-diagnosis. and that really is the best place to start, is that we, through reading a little bit about the essences and feeling their energy, some people use dowsing for this, and especially when you're using it for yourself, there's absolutely no harm in using dowsing. When you become really familiar with the essences, there's no need to use a pendulum anymore. Although sometimes I check up if there's a couple of remedies that I'm not quite sure which one might be best, you know, I'll check with a pendulum. But familiarizing yourself with the essential qualities of the remedy, you can't do without that. So self-diagnosis first is most important. And then when you've really familiarized yourself with them, taken the remedies, got to know them as you get to know people in a way, you can take them on a daily basis. If you've got something coming up, you think, oh, I'm feeling a bit kind of lacking in confidence today, I'll have a few drops of larch, that'll help me. Or a really familiar one is the combination of remedies in the rescue remedy. You've probably heard of the rescue remedy. It's a brilliant combination of remedies for any kind of shock or trauma or visit to the dentist or anything that you're, if there's been an accident, a few drops of rescue remedy can really calm things down and help the person to kick in their own healing process and take the shock and the stress and the trauma out of the situation, which is really brilliant. So it's really the art of the practitioner, which is what I call myself. I call myself an experienced practitioner. And although I did qualify with the Bach Centre in Wallingford, down near Oxford, I didn't keep up my registration because it was costing me a lot of money and I was getting so much paperwork through the post I couldn't keep up with it. So although I did that, I don't actually use that anymore. I call myself a practitioner, and the art of the practitioner is to be so familiar with the remedies that when somebody presents themselves to me for a pre-diagnosis chat, which is what we always have, the best way to find out which remedies people need is to sit down and have a chat. So there'll be some questions I will ask, and the chat is most important because it's not just the words people use, it's their body language, it's everything about them, basically. So the art of the practitioner is just to choose the right remedies for that person at that moment in time when they present themselves to you. That's the most important thing. You might be able to diagnose personally that they will probably need, there'll be another remedy that they'll need a bit later on, but initially you deal with the person as they present themselves to you. And it's very important for the practitioner as well not to present the negative aspects of the need for that remedy. That's so important. And when I'm running through the photographs in a minute, you might think that some of them, that the summaries of the essences might sound a little bit negative, but that's because that's how we recognize the need for the remedy. You know, if somebody is seriously lacking in self-confidence, we'll probably know straight away that larch will be needed. But it's about presenting that to the person in a positive way. You might ask a question, you know, how do you feel before you do such and such? I feel a bit anxious. Well, would you like something to help you with that feeling? I've got a bottle here and a few drops of that will really help you with that feeling. And then they take it. So it's very important not to present a negative picture to the person, because the last thing you want them to do is go away from the diagnosis thinking, oh, I'm impatient, I've got no confidence, I'm really negative, you know, kind of, oh. So you don't want that to happen. So, before we go through the pictures, are there any questions people would like to ask before we look at the individual remedies? No, we're all happy. Be time for questions at the end anyway. So, this is an illustrated introduction to the Bath Care Remedies. It's that one. Okay. And we start. I'm doing them in alphabetical order for simplicity. And that's the way Mechtel Schaefer puts them in this book as well. So I've familiarised myself with them in alphabetical order, basically. Works for me. So agrimony is a really beautiful, delicate yellow flower that we find, I haven't actually seen any around here, but you do find it growing in the wild in Wales. It's around. Very pretty little flower. Basically, agrimony is for people who present a really positive, cheerful face to the world, but maybe they're hiding some less positive, cheerful thoughts inside, which they're covering up with the persona they present to the world. And so somebody in need of remedy, of this remedy, will probably appear incredibly happy and jolly. I used to need, agrimony is probably my type remedy. I used to need it a lot. When you've taken agrimony for a while, you will find that you no longer need to present this jolly, jolly face, that you will accept more of what's going on inside you and have a more balanced presentation. It's about the way we deal with the world. So agrimony is a very useful remedy. Aspen, beautiful tree. Did I have two photos of this? Yeah, there's the tree. And it's a very elegant tree. It also has leaves which quiver in the wind very beautifully, very delicately, make a little sound. And aspen, the essence aspen, is for people who have vague, inexplicable fears about the world around them. They tremble a little bit too much at the thought of going out into the world. So they're very sensitive people. And by taking aspen, they will be able to calm that tremor that they feel. And I think probably everybody has had that, a little bit of that, at times in their lives, to calm that tremor down and enable them then to get in touch, because they're sensitive people, to get in touch with other realms where they will be able to use that sensitivity positively. So, you know, spiritual connection, intuitive connection, all those other skills that we have, especially aspen people, will be able to be used more positively and to calm those fear tremors. Some Mechtel Schaefer describes it as a secret fear of some impending evil. You don't know what it is, but you know you're afraid of it. There's another one to do with fear that we'll come on to, which is a different kind of fear. Beech. That's a beech flower, a beech tree flower, which are very beautiful. You don't often see them. They quite often soon turn into nuts. And beech is for quite a hard, critical attitude towards the world. You want to be right about everything. A beech type is quite often intolerant and critical of other people because they think they know best. They're right. But that can have quite an isolating effect on the person. So by taking beech, it will enable them to calm and look at their own critical attitude and bring it into use as more the quality of discernment, because they're quite discerning people, but it often comes out as criticism. Taking the remedy will bring that discernment into a more interactive, personable approach, rather than just saying, oh well, you're doing it wrong. Do it like this. We all know people like that. You don't want to do it like that. You want to do it like this. So yeah, but not in such a nice way. Beech people can be quite, harsh in their criticism, so it comes out wrong quite often, and that makes them unpopular, which feeds back into their critical attitude. So Beach can help with that. Centauri, another very, very beautiful little flower. And it's quite useful sometimes if you know somebody of this type, you can bring them to mind and it'll help to remind you of the quality of the essence. And Centauri people are very good-natured, good-willed, but they will quite often let that good nature be taken advantage of, and they will feel exploited because they never say no. They can't say no to anybody. So they'll overuse their goodwill and their good nature. They'll end up running around for other people all the time and never really feel centered and nourish themselves inside. So again, I know people who demonstrate the quality of that essence quite in some detail, and I would love to give them some Centauri, and hopefully I'll get the chance. Cerato. In the book it gives you all the Latin names, and Bach as well gives you all the Latin names for the plants if you want to check that out. This one's got a lovely name, Ceratus stigma wilmottiana. Beautiful name. Beautiful blue colour, doesn't quite show up on there. Baby blue eyes. And Cerato is to do with not having confidence in your own decisions. You might feel an inner voice making a decision for you, but you won't believe it. So you haven't got confidence in your own intuitive powers. And it's so important in this world, I think, that we get in touch with our intuition. And there are many, many ways to do that. And I think over this weekend, there's been a lot of talk about how we can get in touch with our own inner voice, our own intuition. And that's so important. So somebody who needing Cerato, they feel the connection with their intuition is poor. It's not strong. By taking Cerato, they'll begin to hear that inner voice a bit more clearly and will have confidence in expressing it, rather than thinking, oh no, that's rubbish. I'm not doing that. That's rubbish. That came from me. It can't be right. You know, that kind of thought. Cherry plum. Now this is one of the really important ingredients of Rescue Remedy. Cherry plum is for fear of letting go inside. You might have actually fear of losing your mind. You're on the edge of something that some people call insanity. It can be quite an acute state. It can also be less acute. It's just a feeling of that feeling you might get before you get angry with somebody, or that feeling you if you're prone to outbreaks of temper, which you might well be if you need cherry plum, then a few drops of cherry plum might help you to integrate that feeling of anger and do something positive with it, rather than burst out with a lot of negative words, which often don't help. I don't know if you've had that experience where you've been angry, whether it's with somebody else or with yourself. It's often not helpful, and it will put your system under a lot of stress, and stress is really, really bad for us. So anything we can do to get ourselves out of that state of stress is really good. Cherry plum, really good for that. Chestnut bud. Chestnut bud is for someone who seems to be making the same mistakes over and over again. They keep thinking, oh yeah, well I've done that before and I've just done it again. Or you buy something that's the wrong colour for you, and then you realise it's the wrong colour for you, and you go out and buy something else in the same colour. You think, oh, it doesn't suit me, why am I doing this? You know, it can be something really small like that. or it can be something a bit more, a bit deeper. As with all of these remedies, there is a kind of a superficial need for taking something like chestnut blood. It can be on a daily basis, or it can be something a bit deeper, where you've been making the same mistakes over and over again, right throughout your life. And chestnut blood can help with that. Because as with all of the remedies, some of them perhaps more so than others, they go right back to our beginning. You're not just taking that essence for this moment. They go right back to the beginning of your existence, possibly to before you were conceived. Chicory, another really beautiful blue flower. Now, chicory presents itself quite often as an overly possessive attitude. It comes from a place of caring, but quite often, when it's out of balance, it can present itself as excessively interfering with other people and what they're doing, secretly manipulating them, and also somebody who needs chicory will be demanding full support from everybody around them. So they'll be secretly interfering with everybody, overly concerned about everybody, manipulating people, and And quite often, if they don't get their own way, they will lapse into a feeling of self-pity where they'll need even more support. So this can be recognised. Sometimes I've seen it in the parent-child relationship. Although the mother, or the father indeed, is coming from a place of love, it sometimes expresses itself in a overly concerned way. And this isn't necessarily what the child needs to be nurtured towards independence and getting in touch with their own intuition. So it's about balancing that. Taking chicory can really help to transform that into a more positive, loving care for people rather than this kind of manipulating desire. Clematis, old man's beard, traveller's joy. We don't see it in this area because there's no line right here. If you drive into a lime area with a lot of chalk and limestone, you'll see it growing all over the hedgerows. Climbs like fury. It's our native clematis. And clematis is quintessentially for somebody who loves to daydream. They're off, they're not really in the present, they're daydreaming all the time, they'd probably rather be asleep. So there's a kind of an extreme state of the clematis where you would be asleep and happier in your dreams or your daydreams than you are dealing with present life. Now there's nothing wrong with daydreaming, I think it's a really, really creative thing to do. But we do need to learn when to daydream and when not to daydream and to interact with the world. So for somebody who wants to bring a bit more focus into their lives, who find themselves retreating into daydream, which I'm so familiar with, then clematis can help. It's also another really important remedy for clematis, for rescue remedy, because somebody in a state of shock might well be retreating from consciousness, and clematis can really help to bring people back into a conscious state. So clematis is another really important ingredient of that. Crabapple. You all familiar with crabapple? The wild apples that grow in our hedgerows? This is made from the flowers of the crabapple, which are really beautiful in the spring. Early summer, you've seen them, tree covered in blossom. Very beautiful plant. Somebody who needs crabapple is going to feel
like they need to let off steam.
It's going to feel like they need to let off steam. Not exactly. Not exactly. Thank you, Trey. Clematis is for somebody who feels unclean. and stuff down the toilet and all that kind of thing might need some crab apple, because it's the internal self that needs that cleansing, not the external self, really. I'm a great believer, as some of you know, in developing a healthy immune system. And somebody who needs crab apple wouldn't be happy eating wild food without sterilizing it first. As we were saying the other day, you know, I never wash any wild food I pick, because I try to make sure it's picked in the cleanest place possible. There's no need to wash it. So somebody who needs crab apple would be over concerned with hygiene. What they really need to do is to look inside and cleanse their inner self, if you like, so that that obsession with outer cleanliness becomes less apparent, less important. You know, we do need to eat a bit of food off the floor occasionally, and we do need to get germs into our system. We need to put less of that stuff, what do they call it, antibiotics and all those things which kill all of our healthy flora and fauna. Let's be a bit more natural with that process. So crab apple people will feel the need to be externally clean lessen. Elm flower, who'd have thought it? That's an elm flower. Very beautiful. An elm is for a feeling of somebody who's really dedicated to their work, whatever it is they do, but they've reached a point of feeling overwhelmed. And usually it's a relatively temporary state. It's a temporary feeling of inadequacy. A few drops of elm can bring somebody back to that feeling of, yeah, of course I can do this. I do it every day. So it's for that temporary feeling of, oh, can I really? Described as weak moments in the lives of the strong. Psychological smelling salts. So you probably could even sniff the elm remedy and it would do it, but a few drops would be better. So it'll just give you that lift you need. Gentian. That doesn't do the gentian justice at all, that photograph, because again, it's one of the most beautiful blues you've ever seen. It grows wild on our chalklands. We don't see many gentians in the acid land of Wales. You might see some up, I don't know, around Llangollen. There's some limestone up there. But it is a beautiful flower, and it's a very delicate flower. And gentian, the key word for gentian really is sceptical. Some people are perhaps a little bit more sceptical than is good for them. I mean, healthy scepticism, fine, but the gentian type would just constantly be coming out with a sceptical thought or a sceptical phrase. They doubt everything, quite pessimistic about the outlook, and easily discouraged. A few drops of gentian can really help people to open up to the possibility that this might work. So actually giving somebody who's really sceptical a few drops of gentian might open them up to the healing qualities of the whole system of remedies. That's very useful. Gorse. We saw gorse on our walk the other day and we ate a few of the flowers because they're really nice in salads. Gorse flowers are delicious. But gorse, as we mentioned, is for a sense of utter hopelessness. There is no hope. What's the point? Despair. Oh, what's the use of even trying? And you might get that as a temporary state, you might have that as a longer term state in your life. A few drops of gorse will again help to lift that feeling of despair. It's far more serious than elm, the temporary feeling of inadequacy. This is just, what's the point? So gorse again can open people up to the potential benefits of taking the remedies. Heather, very common on our hillsides in Wales, to acid lover. Heather types are very interesting because they can seem, they're quite needy. So they really, really want to talk about themselves and their own troubles, and they will ear hole anybody who comes in within speaking distance, and they want to tell you all about their lives and their problems. So they can be quite self-obsessed, and needing an audience. Children quite often demonstrate the need for Heather, constantly wanting attention, not able to entertain themselves at all. They will need you there all the time. So it quite often shows itself quite clearly in children, but also in older people. You probably know some Heather types, and a few drops of Heather can bring them into connection with people so that they can listen to other people and not just need to talk themselves all the time. So it's about listening, opening up the possibility. You might learn something if you listen. It's about opening that possibility up. There's quite a few of them, there's 38 of them, so I hope you're still with me. I'm running through them as briefly as I can. Am I going fast enough? Yeah, is that all right? Holly, we've got all the time in the world. Holly is great. Holly has been associated with redemption. And the key note for Holly is, well, really, it's about opening up to love. But the negative state of Holly is to do with jealousy, distrust, feelings of hatred and envy at all levels. And we tackled this in the ceremony the other day. It's time to let go of our jealousy, of our guilt, of our regret. There's another remedy for that, but jealousy is not a very helpful emotion to be feeling. It comes up in Desiderata as well, you know, that we will always compare ourselves to other people to find out where we think we are on the scale of things. We're all in this together, you know. We're all striving to live our lives. It's about that acceptance. So, feelings of jealousy, distrust, hatred, envy, a few drops of Holly can open you up to the possibility of love, essentially. Holly is a key remedy. And I mean, it's not just love for other people, it's love of ourselves, which is probably where we start. If we can love ourselves, then it'll be much easier to bring that love out into the world and share it with other people. If you're not feeling loving towards yourself, you're highly unlikely to be able to bring that love out into the world to other people. So love to everything. Holly can open up that possibility for people. Honeysuckle. What a beautiful flower. Do you remember eating it when you were a child to get the nectar from the base of the honeysuckle stem? It's a very edible flower. You can eat honeysuckle flowers. You can make wine out of it. You can do all sorts of things with it. The honeysuckle in the essence is... It's a longing for the past and living in regret over the past. Again, we bring this up in the ceremony. We have to let go of our regret, because whatever's happened to us in our lives has happened. And all we can do, the best thing we can do with all the experiences we've ever had, is to learn from them and do things differently next time. So somebody in the honeysuckle state is not living in the present at all. Not like the clematis person who's just daydreaming away. Honeysuckle people are actually actively living in the past, don't want to let go of it, are stuck in that regret state, and they can't live in the present, move forward at all. So it's taking honeysuckle enables you to let go, have a more positive relationship with the present, because you're suddenly aware of the possibilities of the learning, everything you've ever learned comes into play, and we'll guide you from then on. So you can let go of that stuff, learn from it, and move on. Hornbeam, a lovely plant. Beautiful little flowers. Leaves a bit like a birch tree. So it's called Carpinus betulus, which means leaves a bit like a birch tree. Hornbeam is for something I'm sure you've all felt at one point or another, whether it was a Monday or not. It's that Monday morning feeling. It's like, oh, don't want to get up this morning. Don't want to do that. Don't want to do this. So it can be a temporary state. If it's been going on for some time, it can be a bit deeper. But a few drops of hornbeam will help to help enable you to get up, face the day, get on with it. Later on in the day, you'll realise that those feelings you had when you woke up about, oh, do I have to, will dissipate. You'll get on with the day. Everything will be fine. You realise you could do it. After all, everything's fine. Taking hornbeam will enable you to break that cycle of that feeling that some people get in the morning before a day of whatever it is. It needn't be a Monday, but it is described as the Monday morning feeling. Impatiens, one of my favourite flowers. It has become so common in our land. Some of the conservationists were trying to eradicate it, but we've lost that battle. I think we should just enjoy it. It grows by the water. Don't know if you've seen it. It's got seed heads which pop and scatter their seeds for yards about you. And it's related to our Busy Lizzie. You know the little Busy Lizzie plants? It's closely related in Patians. Busy Lizzie is actually quite a good little phrase for this type. Very impatient. Hasn't got had any patience with other people's methods. You'll want them to hurry up. You're not even fast enough for yourself. You want to do it quicker. And this can make you irritable. This can make you short-tempered. And you might have what might be called an excessive reaction to somebody else's slowness. So Empatians will help you to be able to just stand back a bit, let people do it their way, and maybe gently make a suggestion about how that might be done differently, or talk to them about it. You won't be standing there tapping your foot to say, for goodness sake, get on with it, will you? Lose that irritation that people feel sometimes. So it is, quintessentially, it's about patience. us having patience with other people, because everybody's in a different place. We need to have patience with each other.
Do they grow really tall?
They do. Grow really tall. They can grow taller than me.
I wondered what they were.
But yeah. Impatiens glandifera, I think.
Is it the Himalayan balsam?
It is. It's known as the Himalayan balsam. It probably came, the Victorians probably brought it from the Himalayas. Which is quite interesting, really. We've got several Himalayan plants that have naturalised in this country, some of which are a problem because they're invasive. But we've lost the battle with this one now. Let's just enjoy it. Yeah. It spreads in water. The seeds spread really easily.
Bees love it.
We
just
need
when
more.
You said Busy Lizzie, I tend to talk to the smaller plants.
Yes, no.
But these are really, they're all up the bank.
Yeah, yeah. Very large flowers, yeah. Very beautiful. Yeah. That's Impatiens. That's the one Bach used for this remedy, that particular one. Larch. I've mentioned larch. That's a large flower, which I don't know if anybody's ever looked at large flowers in the spring. They are the most beautiful things. Very bright pink. These eventually turn into the cones, I believe. And larch is about that feeling, which might be temporary. It might be more of a long-term state with people. It's a feeling of just a lack of self-confidence. I can't do this. Oh, I've had a great idea. No, I couldn't do that. So you're constantly backing away from things, not trying things, because you feel you're not going to be able to do it. So what's the point in even trying? So larch is a very useful remedy for, and it might be used, for example, if you've got an exam or something, or a test of some kind, and you're feeling, oh, I'm not sure I can do this. A few drops of larch, of course I can do this, to the best of my ability anyway. I might not succeed 100%, but who cares? I'm going to do this my way. I can do it. So it's about that lovely feeling of enablement, if you like. Mimulus. We mentioned aspen at the beginning, and aspen is for vague, inexplicable, unknown fears, whereas mimulus is for fears we know exactly what they are. So it might be a fear of an animal, or it might be a fear of lightning, it might be a fear of going into a room full of crowded people. It quite often shows itself as a shyness in people. Not quite sure about putting myself forward there. I'm just going to step back and feel a bit afraid, because that's what I do. A few drops of mimulus can really help with that. It's not so much about a lack of self-confidence. It's about the fear that has become predominant inside us. So fear is the predominant emotion. Again, we tackle this in the ceremony as well. It's about letting go of that fear. And mimulus can help you do that. Because we don't want to be making decisions in our everyday life that are inspired by a feeling of fear, because they're highly unlikely to work out for the best for anybody. Mustard. Well, I mean, we get fields full of this stuff. It does grow in the wild as well. Mustard is a very interesting remedy. Have you ever seen somebody who looks like they've got their own personal dark cloud that follows them around like this, and nothing is going to get them from underneath their black cloud? Some people call it, I've heard it called the black dog. Some people feel that they have a black dog with them all the time. So mustard is for dispelling a feeling of gloom, melancholia. And this might appear really suddenly out of the blue. Oh, you've got your own personal dark cloud. The black dog is with you and you can't shake it. It might just disappear just as quickly as it came. But if you recognise this in your life, then you probably need to take mustard to break that pattern. Because we all develop patterns from when we're, even before we're conceived, we're beginning to develop patterns in our lives. All the experiences we've had since we've been embodied on this planet are evident in the person that we present to the world here and now. So mustard can help dispel those feelings of gloom and despondency. It can even help in cases of depression, where that has become a serious pattern for people. It can help you to break very gently out of that. Oak, one of our trees. There's many, many oak trees growing around here. And oak present themselves as very strong, very durable, very long-lived, very stable plants when they become trees. They can be quite delicate when they're seedlings. And oak is for somebody who basically gives far too much of themselves. They work too hard. They can't stop. They will eventually be brought to their knees by the effort of doing everything they do. The difference between elm and oak: elm is a temporary state and work is seen as a vocation, whereas oak, work is a duty and a commitment, and the exhaustion from oak may be chronic. So I can see this everywhere. You can see oak types overdoing it, they need to take a step back, maybe take a few drops of oak and give some time to themselves, not just burn themselves out in the outside world. You can see it happening all the time. And it will bring you back to a position of strength, that strength that encompasses your own well-being as well as the well-being of others, not just give yourself out until you burn out, when you're no good to anybody then. Olive. A lovely plant. I don't know where Bach got his olive from. Possibly he went to the Mediterranean, I don't know. It's one of the few plants in the whole system that isn't available in our land. Although you can grow olives in greenhouses and places like that. In its natural state, it's Mediterranean. An olive is for a state of complete exhaustion, extreme physical and mental fatigue. And it might be after a long period of strain or even a physical illness where you're completely wiped out and you need to be brought back. Somebody maybe has given too much of themselves when they've been caring for somebody else. They've been nursing somebody through a long illness, and eventually olive will be needed when there are no inner reserves left. Completely exhausted. As I go through, you can see that there are some similarities between the remedies, and that's the art of the practitioner then to decide which one is most appropriate for that moment. Hornbeam, we mentioned, is more for a tiredness which exists in the mind and can be a very temporary state, whereas olive is for complete mental and physical exhaustion, which can be quite deep and more long-term. So it's a deeper working remedy, deeper action. Pine flowers. Quite pretty. We talked about this before, those feelings of regret and self-reproach and guilt, that's the key word for pine, is you're feeling quite guilty about something that's happened in the past, maybe way back, or something that's happened fairly recently. You might not even be aware of it, but it will present itself in your life as you're constantly criticizing yourself, because that's what you're feeling inside, is self-criticism, self-reproach, and a feeling of guilt, whether it was something that happened this morning or 30 years ago, it doesn't matter. It'll work on everything that you've ever felt guilty about. It will help you transform that into, I suppose, ultimately, forgiveness of yourself and of everybody else, and everything everybody else does. It's ultimately about forgiveness. Pine. Red chestnut. Very, very beautiful flower. Red chestnut is somebody who feels concerned about the welfare of others, but it has become a bit over concerned. So there's an energetic connection between somebody who needs red chestnut and the person they're feeling concerned about. There's almost there's an emotional, energetic connection. And the person who needs the red chestnut can actually affect that other person detrimentally with their over-concern. So it's about taking a bit of red chestnut and transforming that concern again into a more balanced care rather than worry. Somebody who needs red chestnut will think about the worst possible outcome of a situation. You might be watching somebody else doing something and you'll think, oh, they're going to fall, they're going to cut themselves, they're going to hurt themselves. That's not going to help them or you, basically. It's a stress for both people involved. My mum used to worry about me when I got on an aeroplane. And I said, really, ma'am, that's the worst thing you could do for me, is worry about that plane crashing. I really would rather you imagined a safe landing, because that energetically, that's far more likely to work for us. And even the people on the aeroplane as well, it would be really nice if people who are on an aeroplane together could meditate together about the success of that flight and a safe landing, you know, rather than people get really afraid and worried about flying. And I know how that feels too. So Red Chestnut is transforming that excessive concern into a proper care and love. Well, Rock Rose is another element of Rescue Remedy, and it is again related to fear, but it's an extremely acute state of fear, terror and panic. Somebody is really about to have possibly a panic attack or something like that. Rescue Remedy will work, but a few drops of Rock Rose would work for that state as well. Very beautiful flower. I saw it growing profusely in the Peak District a few weeks ago. It was everywhere. That's a limestone area, and this is another lime lover. So it's a beautiful little plant. Helianthemum, related to the sun. Helios, the sun, I believe. Opens in the sunshine. So Rock Rose can act again very, very quickly on that state of fear and panic, which is why Rescue Remedy is such a brilliant mixture to be carrying around with you. Really useful to have a little bottle of that in your bag. Take it everywhere, because you never know when you're going to need it. Rock water. This, I think any spring water, obviously, as clean as possible and as close to source as possible, will serve to make the remedy rock water. I think Bach originally used a well near where he lived in Brightwell cum Sotwell near Wallingford. But again, as with any water we drink, the closer to source it comes from, the purer it will be. So if you can go to the source of a spring or a well, or even the source of a river, and get the water from there, then it's very young, energetic water. The Wye, the River Wye, comes bursting out of the rocks at the base of Plinlimmon Mountain in a most biblical fashion. Just comes gushing forth, and you can obviously drink it straight from there, and it's wonderful. So young, alive water. And rock water is for those who are particularly hard on themselves. They might have very strict, rigid ideas about how things should be done. Their own health might be approached in a very, very strict, rigid way. There'll be no leeway, no lax behaviour on their part. But they're so fixed and rigid in their ideas that they want to show an example to others. So by being so pure, you want to influence other people so that they might find the right path. But that will be the right path that you found for yourself, not necessarily the right path for somebody else. So rock water will help to soften that trait, enable people to be a bit less rigid and fixed in their thinking, be a bit more flexible, and be a bit more open to other people's paths and ways of doing things. So we can all make suggestions, we can talk about the way we do things, but not in this kind of rigid. You know, somebody who runs around the block 5 times, comes home to a specially prepared breakfast and only drinks this and da da da, and then expects other people to behave like them, would be in need of a few drops of rock water. Nothing wrong with doing those things. It's your attitude to those things that matter. So rock water, very useful. Scleranthus. Pretty little plant. Somebody who's needing scleranthus will be vacillating all the time between shall I do this or shall I do this? And this might be quite small things in your everyday life, or it might be more major life decisions. And you end up so torn between the extremes of, shall I do this or this? Shall I go to Africa or Cardiff? You know, it could be quite a big thing, but you'll end up not making any decision at all because you're too busy vacillating between one extreme and another, or one decision and another. You might never make the decision. And your moods and your opinions can be very volatile when you're in need of Sclerantis, because you can't decide on anything and you're vacillating between, shall I be happy or shall I be down? So you're vacillating, you don't know where you stand. So Sclerantis can really help with that vacillation, which might be on a temporary thing. You might wake up feeling really undecisive about everything that morning. A few drops of Sclerantis can help you make the decisions you need to make and get on with the day. It can be that simple, it can be a lot deeper. You might be a Sclerantis type, which would be a very difficult one to cope with, because you will have found it hard to make any decisions throughout your whole life. So taking some Sclerantis can help you back into a process of action and decision making that will bring you out of that state of indecisiveness and inaction and confusion. There can be a lot of confusion with Sclerantis. Star of Bethlehem. Again, the slide doesn't do it justice. It's a very beautiful flower. And this is another very important ingredient of Rescue Remedy. And it's probably one of the remedies I use most often, because the key words for Star of Bethlehem are, it is a comforter and soother of pains and sorrows. And there probably isn't anybody in this room who could say that they've never needed comfort and soothing of pain or sorrow. And the nice thing about it is that it goes right back to our beginning. Even before we were born, our pattern started forming, and we might be in need of comforting and soothing right back to our time of birth. But everything that's happened to us ever since then will be soothed, comforted. Even grief that you didn't know you had from when you were a child, this can really help to work with that. It can also help with shock and the after effects of physical, mental, or even psychic experiences which have been really frightening. And even if they're not happening now, this will help, this will go back into your experience to sort that out. And that's one of the things I love about every single remedy, is that it's not just treating the person that's presenting themselves to you, it is treating the whole person right back to their beginning. Sweet chestnut. Love them. Very pretty flowers they have as well. I don't know if you've ever noticed sweet chestnut flowers. Very pretty. Sweet chestnut can be described as the back to the wall feeling. Dark night of the soul are other key words for sweet chestnut. You might be feeling absolutely dejected, and you believe you have reached the limits of your endurance, and sweet chestnut can bring you back into a state of, it's quite an extreme state. Again, it can be taken on a less extreme level, but normally sweet chestnut presents itself as quite an extreme condition. Vervain, very pretty, delicate little plant. Vervain is for people who maybe have a good cause that they feel really enthusiastic about, but they get a little bit too enthusiastic about their cause. So they want to tell everybody about it. They even strain their own energy in telling people about it. So people might, you might find when you're in an extreme vervain state that people will start backing off from you because you're a bit too much. It can present itself as being highly strung and even fanatical about a cause. And this won't ultimately help you or your cause, because to present it in a reasonable, balanced way is more likely to win you support. By taking vervain, it'll enable you to do that, and you would then find that people won't be backing away from you. They'll be coming towards you and want to find out what it is you're talking about. So we've all seen people. I was wondering whether somebody who might be on the prow of a Greenpeace ship, battling with the elements, battling with the conservation or the lack of conservation, fighting sometimes at the risk of personal safety, might benefit from a few drops of vervain. I'm not saying that people shouldn't do that Greenpeace stuff, but there may be a slightly less fanatical way of approaching some of those issues. It struck me that that might be a case for vervain. Vine, the grapevine, that is the flower of the grapevine, which looks like some kind of alien to me. Amazing. They'll all turn into little grapes eventually. Vine, I always think of Margaret Thatcher, I can't help it. When I think of vine, I think of Margaret Thatcher, because the key words for vine are dominating, inflexible, and striving for power. So you can understand why Margaret Thatcher springs to mind. She was called the Iron Lady, and she was all of those things, I think. She was domineering, inflexible, and she definitely strove for power. You don't have to be a Margaret Thatcher to be presenting vine. You will want to be in a position of power over other people, and that is probably not a very healthy place for us to be. And through taking vine, it will, what's the word, soften your ambition and enable you to work with other people to achieve collective aims rather than you laying it on. You might have leadership qualities, in fact you probably will, but it's about learning how to use those qualities with the team rather than using it in a dictatorial, power-crazy fashion, which is vine in its imbalanced state. I don't know what would have happened to Margaret Thatcher if we had given her some vine. Would have been interesting to try, but I shouldn't have think she'd have been open to it. She was too far gone in the negative vine state to be open to such a thing.
It was still a help, though.
It might have helped. It might have changed the course of history. Walnut. We're getting near the end of this selection of remedies now. Walnut is a very useful remedy, and it can be used any major transition in our lives. It can be absolutely anything which requires us to make a major transition. So it can be a physical transition, like giving birth, or the menopause, or all sorts of, indeed, life and death. It might help at the end of somebody's life to enable them to let go of the shore in a positive way to move forwards. It's been described as somebody who's sitting in a boat, but the boat is still attached to the shore, and they need to cast off from the shore and get into the flow of the river and go with it. So hanging on, not like honeysuckle, which is a longing and regrets over the past. Walnut is an inability to let go of the past and taking it will enable you to resist powerful influences and follow your true ambitions. Cast the boat off from the shore. it can be used in so many instances. It's phenomenal. Many, many, anything really transitional you can use walnut for. Water violet. As you can see, it's growing up out of the water. It has a very delicate stem. The roots and the leaves are quite often under the water, and water violet grows up above. Somebody needing water violet is going to be feeling isolated because they have withdrawn inside. They have that quality of inner reserve, which might present itself as a calm, slightly aloof persona. But they've become isolated through this. And they might actually have genuine qualities which would set them apart from other people. And they might be really good people in an emergency, for example, because they will stay calm, they'll be able to stand back and look at what needs doing. But in the negative water violet state, they won't be able to enact their best impulses because they're feeling withdrawn and proud and isolated. So that can help to bring them out of that state. And in a positive state, they will be an island of calm, confidence and tranquility, but they will also be approachable by other people. In the negative state, they won't be approachable, they won't even want to be approached because they might be sitting on their own somewhere, feeling superior. White chestnut, another very useful remedy for people who can't turn their brains off. Sometimes it manifests itself as not being able to go to sleep. Very useful for helping with not being able to sleep, because white chestnut is for those thoughts that just keep going round and round in your head. You can't switch them off. They might drive you a little bit crazy. You wake up in the middle of the night, there they are again. Oh no, what am I going to do? Can't turn these thoughts off. Mental arguments, diagnosing the day, diagnosing the following day. Can't turn it off. A few drops of white chestnut can really release you from that. And if you get a good night's sleep, you're far more able to cope with the day and the challenges it presents to you. And you won't be, really, it's for worry. That kind of internal wrangling, worrying that just goes on for some people constantly. A few drops of white chestnut can really help with that. Wild oat. Now, this one's an interesting one because it's for somebody who feels not like sclerantus, so they can't decide what they're going to do. Somebody needing wild oat is very unsure about the direction they want to take. It might be a life direction, and there is an element as well of disappointment and dissatisfaction with somebody who needs wild oat because they feel that they haven't fulfilled themselves in their lives. However old they are, however small or however old they are, wild oat can help people to come into the present, recognise the skills they've got and how they're going to use them. Oh yeah, well this is what I can do with that. Clarity in your ambition, whether it's for the following minute or the following year, it can clear you up, clear up your thoughts. Wild rose, another beautiful flower. You can eat the petals of wild rose, and I think wild rose, it's very sweet, the petals of wild rose, and you can use the rose hips as we were talking about yesterday. And the petals are all shaped as a little pink heart. So I think you're getting a little bit of love from the rose when you eat the petals. The remedy itself is for a complete feeling of apathy, resignation, lack of interest, in anything. You're resigned. And there is this underlying hopeless sadness, which is more extreme even than with Gorse, which is for hopelessness. This is, you have really given up. You, very extreme state. So, Wild Rose is a key remedy for breaking through that paralyzing sadness that some people can feel, which just disables you from doing anything at all, even thinking that this might end, so that this might get better. So Wild Rose is a very sad state and manifests as a feeling of apathy and a lack of interest in anything, completely given up. Willow is another remedy I find coming to mind quite often when I meet people. There's quite a few people out there, I think, who could benefit from some willow. And willow is for that feeling, people who feel like the victim. It's poor me. Nobody's had those awful experiences I've had. Victim fate. You don't know what it's like. I've suffered. Poor me. Unspoken resentment and bitterness about your lot in life. Willow can change all that and enable you to, again, look at your past experiences and everything that's gone to make you what you are today, and enable you to move forward with that learning rather than dwelling on the fact that you've been hard done by. And goodness me, do I know some people who are stuck in this willow state of blaming their experience for how they feel today. Very sad. A few drops of willow can help to sort that out. And goodness me, that is the last remedy. Okay. Did anybody feel any familiarity with any of those remedies as I was speaking?
Yes.
Did some of them, you're familiar with those states? Well, that's the key really, is that's the beginning of opening up to the potential of essences in general, is to feel a relationship with the quality of that plant.
They are quite distinct from each other, aren't they?
They are. Most of them. They are quite distinct. And again, the art of the practitioner is to maybe pull a few remedies together and think, now which one of these is most relevant for this person at this time? So recognising the difference between hornbeam and elm and oak. They all relate to tiredness and exhaustion. A lot of them relate to tiredness and exhaustion, but it's about finding the reasons behind that person's tiredness and exhaustion. Why they're feeling tired and exhausted. Could be very deep. They could be exhausted because they're not sleeping and all they need is a few drops of white chestnut. They could be exhausted because they've been exhausted all their lives and they've seriously depleted their own reserves. They're seriously depleted, so they need some olive maybe for that deeper, you know. So that's the getting familiar with the remedies, being able to choose the right remedy, because quite a lot of them have something in common, but it's about pinpointing. I mean, you could drink the whole box all at once and they wouldn't do you any harm at all. But in my opinion, and over the years I've realised, it's far better to choose 1, 2, possibly 3 remedies at the beginning. I think some people go for too many remedies and it just kind of muddies the water and confuses the issue. If it's really clear to you that that person needs one remedy, that's all you give them to begin the process. And then the next time they come, you might choose another one. or a different one, and combine it maybe. But the simpler the better, the fewer remedies you can use, the better. So, on the Bach Flower Centre's website, there's some wonderful information. You can download this lovely leaflet that Bach wrote all those years ago, and it's called The 12 Healers and Other Remedies. It's there for you, it's free, you can download it, you can print it out as I've done, and you can refer to it. And one really useful thing Bach did as he was discovering these remedies was he put them into groups so it can help you with your diagnosis, especially self-diagnosis at the beginning. So he's got one group which is over care for the welfare of others. So there's many remedies that relate to the overcare of welfare for others, and his little descriptions will help you to choose which one is right for you at that time. And it is so easy to make an essence. It is the easiest thing in the world. Love it, love that. This takes me right back to my childhood. Because when I was a kid, tiny, I lived right by the steam railway line. So that's some of my first memories of that sound. So it takes me back to when I was about 3 years old. So I really enjoy it every time it goes by. Well, I was just thinking about that. Yeah. Well, in fact, this essence that I've been making over the weekend does have influence of steam train in it.
Yeah.
So, when I was out walking the other day, we went on a little walk, I was looking for honeysuckle, because where I live, honeysuckle is abundant. It's everywhere in all the hedgerows. And I was thinking, oh, that'll be simple. I'll make a honeysuckle remedy essence for the festival, the gathering, because it's everywhere. It's one of the Bach flower remedies. Simple. I couldn't find any honeysuckle anywhere. It doesn't grow here at all. I've walked uphill, down dale, no honeysuckle. But this little plant kept presenting itself to me. It kept on popping up in the hedgerows and saying, what about me? Here I am. And it's Campanula. Campanula rotundifolia. Lovely name. Got round leaves. Rotund folia leaf. And it's edible. As we, on the foraging walk yesterday, we ate some of the flowers. You can eat the leaves as well. Very sweet, very delicious. It's very delicate. The stem that this little plant grows on is no bigger than a millimetre thick. Such a delicate little plant. And I've seen this plant flower in the middle of winter at minus 15 degrees centigrade. This plant has been in flower in the garden. So when this plant shouted out at me from the hedgerow, I thought, and I was thinking about what it's for, the key word for this essence, in my opinion, is resilience, because it is such a delicate little plant, such a delicate little flower, and it's actually the structure of the water in many plants enables them to live through below freezing conditions without freezing. So resilience, and all you have to do is get a bowl, it's up there, very simple. Get yourself a nice glass bowl. I picked this one up in a charity shop the other day for £3. Pretty glass bowl. Doesn't have to be pretty, it can be plain. And fill it with the nicest water you can find. So, preferably natural spring rock water. Put it in the sunshine. And with good intent and permission from the plant, pick. Just tune into the plant, ask it nicely. Pick as many flowers as you need to cover the surface of the water and leave it in the sunshine for at least 4 hours. I think that's what it says there. Yeah, 3 to 4 hours. Or less if the blooms begin to show signs of fading. Well, these blooms have totally astounded me because they're still good. I made this remedy on Friday, and we're now Monday. And these have been sitting in the rain, in the sun, out there all night, listening to the train, feeling and absorbing the energy of everybody who's been here. There's a little bit of all of us in this essence. So what I'd like to do, I've already given a bit to you, Vanya, and this is, at the moment, this is pure water. There's no alcohol in it at all. And I know some people are really keen on not having any alcohol at all. Normally what I would do is I would mix the water from this half with half and half alcohol water to preserve it. And that would then become the stock essence. And it's from that that you take a couple of drops to treat somebody. So I could make up a lot of bottles of resilience remedy for people who've been at this gathering if they want to. How I do that, I don't know. I've got some in a bottle here, which has got no alcohol in it, and I would really love to try it out with everybody who's here if they want to. Just put four drops onto your tongue and just let it be. Just put four drops of that onto your tongue. Most of the remedies made by Bach, this is a list of all the remedies made by the sunshine method. We've seen all those beautiful flowers in the slide. It's quite simple. You use the flowers, cover the surface of your lovely water with the flowers, and that will make your essence. It is that simple. And if you can spend some time sitting with your essence while it's in the making, all the better. If you can spend some time sitting with it, meditating with it, putting your good intent and all your lovely vibes of love into that essence, it'll be even more effective. I'm just thinking about somebody who needs impatiens might not have the patience to do that. So you might want to take a bit of impatiens if you haven't got the patience to do that before you sit with your remedy. A few years ago I made my first essence, having worked with the Bach flower essences for years, I made my first essence and it was snowdrop essence. And you all know the snowdrop. It's one of the first flowers to present itself in spring. I think end of January, almost without fail, the snowdrop will poke up its little head and those beautiful white flowers will come out. And when I sat with the bowl in the middle of winter, in the sunshine with my snowdrop essence, I was initially thinking that it would be a remedy that would inspire hope in people, because you could say that snowdrop is a sign of spring, a sign of better things to come, an essence for hope, I thought. When I thought about it some more, and actually after taking some of that snowdrop essence, I realized that it's not about hope at all. It's about trust. And when you think yourselves about the difference between trust and hope, you probably see what I mean. If we trust through taking something like snowdrop essence, we trust that everything's going to be fine, rather than putting hope out as something that's going to be all right, that might be okay tomorrow, and we're off into the future. Trust works here and now, whereas hope might be something that's a bit distant from us. So I've changed it now. It's now called Trust Essence. And I believe it works. I believe, possibly because I believe it works. But I have actually given it to people who have responded that they felt more at ease and being able to go with the flow, let things develop, and trust that everything's going to be fine.
It is remarkable how well they work, isn't it? Because, I mean, I've seen these things being given to people, and you can see people becoming calmer, especially the sleep. And we've seen that work recently, haven't we?
Yeah. They can work on so many different levels. That's the thing, they can work in a first aid kind of sense. With the rescue remedy, that's quite often what you're doing, is you're just using the best remedies we've got for that moment in time. There's been an accident or a shock or a trauma of any kind. Having this on you is one of the best first aid assistance that you can have, because it will help the emotional state of the people who have been involved in the shock, and that will instantly help to calm the situation down. I've used it in some extreme circumstances myself, and I've seen it work almost instantly on people. There's also a rescue remedy cream that you can get, that you can put on for burns. I think there's a spray now available. You can use rescue remedy directly onto the skin as well. For things like burns, it works very well. The cream possibly works a bit better. Yeah. But the other remedies, not that list, but the rest of them, are made using the boiling method. And Bach describes this very beautifully here and in the 12 Healers booklet. There we are. So that's...
Do you want to read through that?
I could do, I suppose. Boiling. The specimens as about to be described were boiled for half an hour in clean, pure water. Fluid is strained off, poured into bottles until half filled, and then when cold, brandy is added as before to fill up and preserve. In most, the blossoms should be used together with small pieces of stem or stalk, and when present, young fresh leaves. So Bach used the sunshine method for everything that he could use the sunshine method on. For things like chestnut bud, it would be quite difficult to use the sunshine method, so he decided to use the boiling method. And that's all he's done to make all 38 remedies, is use one of those two methods. Sorry.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about the water.
Yeah.
If I didn't want to use alcohol in there, would distilled water be okay? Would still preserve it, or make much difference?
You could use distilled water, because it's just a carrier for the remedy.
Right.
Or you could use live water and put a couple of drops of citricidal or something. Grapefruit seed extract would preserve the water.
A couple of drops in
just a drop in a little dropper bottle.
Right, one of those would be plenty.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you were going to make your Herb Robert essence, for example, you can make that yourself, and then you can preserve it with citricidal, and then you'll be able to use it when the Herb Robert isn't available to eat. Something we've all discovered this weekend, the wonderful properties of Herb Robert. The herbalist who is here, Joe, tells us that eating the leaves from Herb Robert is a fantastic cure-all for just about everything. And Andy discovered this through your intuition, Andy.
Well, a friend mentioned it on a foraging walk. I was on an empty stomach at the time, and I had about 5 leaves and a couple of flowers. Within about 15, 20 minutes, I felt really well, like, you know, when someone's doing something for you. So I've kind of kept that up whenever I came on it, and I've always felt better off it. So, like you say, with this kind of doing this way of preparing it, when it's not around in the winter months, it's still able to have a little bit, you know.
Yeah. Mind you can find Herb Robert again. You'd be surprised, you can find it flowering and it's still in leaf in the winter.
Oh, okay.
And hedgerows and bits of gardens and stuff.
Yeah. My old house, it was all year round, wasn't
yeah.
it? Really?
Yeah, you can find it.
It's stuck.
It does. I really like the smell of Herb Robert myself, because it takes me back to scrabbling around in the hedgerows when I was a kid.
We call it Smelly Bob.
The smell of it, yeah. If you make sure you identify it properly, unless you probably know it already, and then just chew a few leaves of Herb Robert whenever you meet it. A, I'll think of Andy, which will be nice. B, I'll think of this gathering, which is where I discovered it. And C, it's going to be good for me, so let's do that. Again, the foraging thing is a way of bringing us into a more intimate relationship with nature. And the essences that will speak to you, that you want to make, that's all about tuning into plants, receiving their wisdom, and using your own intuition as to what that remedy would be for, or what you would use that remedy for, and then you might like to share it with other people once you've proven it to yourself that it's good and that the intent that went into it is good. Because intent is everything. And I was thinking about this. I better finish soon, hadn't I? Yeah? Yeah, I better finish soon. Probably, I have no idea how long I've been.
There's nobody on after you, carry on.
There's nobody on. Intent is really important. And the word intent is used a lot in fields like this. And I was thinking about intent relating to the word hope, or the concept of hope. I think they're quite closely related, because I think it's quite easy to put intent out there as something that might happen in the future. I intend to do this, or my intent is that I will do this. But really, intent is so important, and that intent is actually manifesting in every moment of our lives, right now, right here. This is the manifestation of our intent. We're here. This is it. In a way, you could say that intent is where past and future meet. Because intent isn't something that happened yesterday. And it's not something that you're going to sort out tomorrow. It is what is manifesting our reality for us in this moment. So, not only is it important, we can't survive without it. Everything that happens to us in our lives is inextricably linked with our intent, and it is in the moment that we do that. What more can I say? I mean, has anybody got anything they'd like to ask or say or comment upon? Or has everybody tried that remedy yet? This one is this one. It's this one. It's the harebell. The harebell. It's growing in the hedgerows around here, and it is one of the most beautiful little plants. No, it's not one of the bar flower remedies. It's a new one. It's a gathering essence. It's from this gathering. This essence contains the essence of this gathering. So I will take it with me. I'll get the flowers out now after this. I've been amazed how they've stayed so good. And also, I put in some unopened flowers in here, and they opened in the essence. So it's got the quality of opening flower, blossoming, future potential. It's got all that. Resilience, I think, is the key word for this essence. Because I think that's what we've been doing here the whole weekend, is discovering through talking to other people, listening to other people's wisdom. Practically everything we've done here is about developing our own resilience so that we can cope with whatever the world presents to us. And the more centered and loving and forgiving we can be in that world, then the better able we will be to, one of my favourite phrases is, let's keep the goodwill rolling. If we all have that as our kind of, mantra. It's a good one to have. What can I do in this situation to keep the goodwill rolling? This is what. Let's keep the goodwill rolling. And even if you're just walking down the street, and if you're feeling that's the most important thing in the world, it's more likely to happen. You'll get involved with other people who are also wanting to keep the goodwill rolling. Best thing we can do, because there's enough of that other stuff going on, and we don't want to get bogged down in that, because it might distract us from our life's mission.
I'm just doing a request for those that come into the closing ceremony. Hopefully bring some water as well.
I'll bring this.
If anybody can bring any leaves or herbs or flowers or some other natural object that you'd like to bring to the ceremony to blow in your gratitude for your life, yourself, this festival that's coming together, find what the intent is, what the intent is for gratitude, what different objects mean to you, and any natural materials. If you could bring some to the ceremony, that would be really good. And then we'll do something with them. Thanks, Katie. Well, I'll bring this as it is. I'll bring this as it is. I won't get the flowers out until we've done the... So it's still working, basically. But the essence is still being made as we speak. Did you try some up the back there? Did you want to try some resilience essence? Did you have some, Barry?
I have some.
So I guess that's the end of the official talky bit. We have got the closing ceremony, I think, 2 o'clock, is it, Ditch?
Yeah, probably about that.
Yeah, about 2 o'clock. I smell there's lunch coming from the phone. Yeah. So we can just enjoy these the last bit of the festival, talking to each other and wrapping it up, really. I must say I've had a really marvellous time here. I'd really like to thank everybody who's been involved in the setting it up and the cooking and the running of the thing and all the people coming along. And thanks, Jess, for doing the... doing a lightning guide to the bar of flowers. Yes.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful. I really enjoyed that. So I hope you did too.
Yeah, it was really good.
Was it? Yeah. You're so sweet. Thank you so much for coming. It's the first time I've ever done that.
Wow. Oh, well done.
That was really good.
Are you bringing me to tears now?